So the next project is the Green Dragon Crescent Blade, a blade from Chinese mythology. It started with me and the customer emailing each other back and forth, and he sent me a bunch of different pictures of different ones he liked and different parts from each one he liked. And so this here is kind of an amalgam of what we worked out together. Those of you who like this blade will probably recognize different parts from different versions. So I did these bits with the this head at an angle. Now I've changed to the roundy head for doing the main body. It's faster. These little points were very nerve-wracking. There's a tiny bit of margin of error, like if you just lightly graze the top plate. But a big miss. I mean, yeah, it's just a nightmare. Like, I'm not even sure how you'd fix it. Fresh vinegar. It just completely lifted the scale off the surface overnight. So knife makers, etc., when they were putting brass into blades, or still putting brass into blades, they'd carve out a notch that had a little bit of an undercut and just hammer a piece of brass in there. Because these shapes are so weird and wide, I don't think that's going to work. So I'm going to melt the brass in, braze it to the surface. So the things I'm going to have to watch out for is I don't want the heat to travel out to this edge, this part, because it's so close to this, is going to be particularly difficult. So I'm going to have to make sure that the blue discoloration, I want it to stay around here. Okay, so that was the most, it just missed the actual edge, but like that was the closest point. Everything else is further in, so it shouldn't be a bother. This part was carefully dar ground out. It was hard to do because it had to be like an exact perfect. See that I can't push that through with my hand, but that's fine. I'll hammer it through. I actually want it to be as tight of a fit as possible. Yeah. And what I'll do is you can see I've marked where the it'll sit in the blade and the quarter inch either side, which will probably wind up being much less than a quarter inch, as I carefully grind out this spiral on top of the ingot. Very finicky to do to get it. I don't know, can you see? Symmetrical and more or less the same pitch on both sides. You go from the angle grinder to iron files to sandpaper to this stuff, the Scotch-Brite. I have to be careful doing this because I'm only going to get the one shot at this, I reckon. I mean, you can undo everything with enough work, but don't want to. Yeah, that looks about right. Might need to set this up on something less bouncy. And done. I don't know, can you see it? I'm going to weld the back here, but considering the amount of force it took to do this, it's hardly necessary. I mean, if anything, when it's swung, it's going to meet impact this way. And because this is most of a circle, not just a hemisphere, the amount of force it would take to pop this guy out would be crazy. So this is the join I want to make here in between these two guards. I want to weld this to this and build up enough material that I can grind back and make this look like a continuous slope from here to here. It's, in honesty, I'm not even sure how necessary this weld is, considering how difficult it was to place this in here. But you know, I'm going to do it anyway. Guards, physical guards. People have also suggested to me using anti-spatter, but in my experience, anti-spatter leaves a horrible greasy mess that's difficult to clean off. Like baked, sometimes it's baked into the surface. And you know, like, so you have to, it's like the work and effort to remove that is not worth it compared to just throwing a bunch of crap around, I find. So that's the weld in there, that area. Drafting dots are good for holding templates on. So the idea is to go from a flat thing like this to something like this, where every surface is rounded off. It's a spike, not a blade. So while it'll be jabby, probably, it won't be sharp on the edge, even though that it'll be beveled all the way around. See how that's like the halfway. I had half an idea. I was going to wait till after this was joined onto the handle to braise all of this stuff, but you know, that's half the game of making these, is figuring out what order to make stuff in that you can hide all the joinery best. And I think if I do it now and clean it up now and clean this edge up, you know, because some of the braise will spill over, I'll have a better success, you know, because then I'll be able to return it to this, to the high polish, before I join it on, and then I can just shield this area off. Well, that's my current theory, which is different to before and could change again. Who knows? I may regret doing this. Normally I'd worry about over hardening this stuff, but I'm going to be welding down that end anyway, so if I have hardened it, it'll get hot again when I go to weld it, which might even anneal it. Who knows? I don't. It's still too hot. I find this happens sometimes if you try to polish the brazing off when it's still just that little bit too hot. Yeah, that's hurting me real good. Oh man, this is... And my viewfinder's telling me the truth. This is even hard to see what's going on. Another reason I wanted to do this before joining it to the shaft was brassing, where heat... I used the steel wire brush to polish this up, and that combined with the fact that it was already hot made lots of brass transfer to this surface. Now this brass is like a painfully thin layer, you know, it might be good for cosmetic purposes, but it wouldn't stand any real abuse. But that's that, you know, I'm gonna have to take the grinder and now polish this up again to try and get rid of it again. So that was yet another reason to do this. First, because once it's joined on here, these parts near the back become increasingly hard to reach properly. I've met a lot of Franken grinders in my time, but this I think is the worst one I've ever done. The little housing for the carbon brushes. I used to make fun of the Bosch guys for having the little safety stud on their brush that would pop out. It's like, oh god damn, it's so annoying. But without the safety stud, the carbon brush on this guy, Black & Decker? I think it's a Black & Decker. It wore out and exploded. You know, I made a mess in here. So I had to take these housings out. And then this old broken Bosch one I had, I stole the carbon brush housings out of it and transplanted them, and I mean they kind of fit and the thing does work, but there's no telling how long this arrangement will last. You know, I've been lazy. I normally have one good one and one Franken one, but I really have to order a new one because now I'm down to just the one Franken grinder. So now for doing this part out here, I had this previously polished up fairly fine, so it shouldn't take too much of a cleanup. Rexcut sent me a bunch of these. They're like Scotch-Brite pads with little sandpaper things in between. He was using it on the blade earlier and it seemed to do a pretty good job, so let's see how it does on this. Hard to see on the camera, but those flap disc things did a good job. Everything is flat looking. There's no not flat, but smooth rather. There's no big swirlies. A lot of the rotary tools, sanding tools, leave swirly patterns, and I mean they're there, I can see them, but they're nowhere near as obvious as they normally are. That feels nice. Not to be gross or nothing. But yeah, that feels good. Can you see this thing? The brass part. Let's see. I shadow it, you can kind of see it. So I got this new toy, the pencil grinder. I mean, and it puts way less of a strain on your wrist than the regular grinder does. These little lines, these little in between the hairs of the beard on the bearded dragon, you know, they were very hard to get with the plasma cutter, so this was good for cleaning them up. It's got an impressive amount of torque for something that's air-powered. You know, I find with a lot of air-powered tools, if you lean too hard, they stop. But I guess because the head's so small, it's fine. But the barrel gets hot. Like I don't actually know, is that because I'm using it far more intensively than you're supposed to? But that would be my one complaint. Is not that it gets hot, because you can just wear a glove. But instead it makes me nervous that I'm working the tool too hard. So this little pencil grinder is great for doing the fine detail work, but unfortunately leaves you covered in a layer of horrible spiky glitter. Oh, the die grinder doesn't actually produce sparks, it produces shards. Little tiny splinters of metal. That's what this guy, shop vac, is for. Try to rub them off your skin. All the ones facing in the right direction will get pushed into your skin. I mean, this thing isn't perfect, but it's better than just giving your arm a brisk rub. And of course, because it's fine detail work, I had my face close to what I was working on. Might round off this front edge too, but that's the idea, to try and make it look like a web inside the mouth. So the eye of the dragon head is 3/4 inch, or very close to that. I looked around for a 3/4 inch ball, couldn't find one, but I found a piece of 3/4 inch bar. And since what I really need is not a ball, but a half a ball, you know, I'm just going to use this stuff. So I can have this come out of the surface. I didn't have the 3/4 inch drill, so I drilled it as close as I could and just widened it out a bit. You can see the eye bumping off the surface. Oh, another mistake you can make starting out is not being able to hold things properly if you're trying to grind them. Little vice grips will save your fingers, because even if you're too lazy, you're like, oh, I don't mind, I'm not afraid. You physically won't be able to hold on to a tiny little piece. It'll get too hot too fast. You'll have a firmer, stronger grip, and your shaping will be better if you can just grab a little vice grips. It only takes 2 seconds. So if you have any jewelers in the house, this looks shockingly crude. But to any fellow welder, you can tell that was a little bit on the small side for me. Once all the parts are ground and ready for being joined to the plate, I mark where they're going to go and center punch a bunch of places. They'll be brazed from the front, but from the back of this plate, I want to do plug welds. I managed to get all the way through art college without anyone explaining to me what a center punch was. So if you don't know what a center punch is, and you need to drill holes in specific places, really, you really need one of these. If you're not going to clamp things when you're drilling them, at least wear a glove. When you burst through the last little layer, it can start to spin. And if you're drilling anything that has a funny shape or a sharp edge, for instance, it could really mess your hands up. This other thing I'm doing here, when you burst through a layer of metal, especially if it's an older drill bit, it can leave a nasty bump. Like, you can imagine yourself if you punch through a super thin layer, that kind of shape. So I'm just sanding it off so I can reposition the plate actually flat on the table, as opposed to being raised up on all these little lumpy bumpy bits. Another mistake it's easy to make if you're just starting off is you'll have a hole that has to go near the edge of something like this, and you'll start to you start to drill it and it doesn't have proper support, and it'll start, the back of the plate will start to raise up as it gets pushed down into this groove. But most drill tables can move a little bit, so all you have to do is move it over a little bit so you can get the edge of it on this edge, and then it's now supported on both sides again, and it won't lift as you try to drill it. On thicker pieces of steel or with smaller drill bits, this effect of the piece of steel starting to raise up can really mess up the position of the holes, especially if, like what I'm doing here, there's actually two separate plates and I'm counting on the holes being more or less in the same place on both plates. One little feature I want to get before I braise this plate is the nostril, which will just be a divot into the surface. Hopefully I can make it deep enough that it'll stick out even after brazing. This is a relatively simple trick, but if you have something you need to clamp down, but you either have no clamp that can reach all the way over here, or if you had a clamp that could reach all the way over here, it would be in the way of the exact place you wanted to work. If you get a long piece of steel that can reach over to the other side of your table and clamp that, like, obviously it has to be a thick piece of steel. If it's a flexy one, this won't work. And then you can squeeze it down this way, and now that is locked there. There we go. It needs to be cleaned up a lot, but that's the idea. This part is finicky. You'll be adding the tiniest amount of brass you can, and then using the heat to spread that out as much as you can. On these very small pieces, the brass gets hot, so it's often hard to tell whether you've burnt the brass out and it goes kind of coppery, or whether you've run out of brass and you're just heating up the metal. You know, it's easier to see what you're doing on the big pieces. This you have to do more by feel, but the main mistake you can do is add too much brass. So that's the just the littlest amount, and then spread it out with the heat. And the brass kind of chases the heat, so you have a big lump over here. You heat over here. Don't heat the big lump. Heat the area ahead of the big lump, and the big lump will follow. It'll go, and then you can kind of spread it out that way. This here, don't ever do that. It's stupid. The correct way to do this would be to clamp the part down and to use the steel wire brush on it. But these little parts are too small for that. It's just a total pain in the ass. Remember a story about a guy in Florida who had prison tattoos on his face. But you know, he was trying to restart his life. So he took one of these guys and he grinded them away. Like the tenor of the stories at the time was, oh wow, look at this gruesome crazy thing. And it was kind of crazy. But you kind of have to admire such commitment to leaving your past behind. I have spent the last 10 minutes looking for my small ball peen hammer. Can you see it? Can you see it, everyone? Oh, like, is it in the pile of hammers? No. Is it on the ground? No. Is it on the worktop? No. And then finally, just as I was going insane, I spotted it here. I don't know how it got there. I don't know how it lined up so that it was kind of hidden underneath the seat. But there you go. So now the mission is to put welds in these holes. I would have preferred, like usually when I'm doing this, 3/8 is the smallest hole I'm happy to put a plug weld into. Especially this MIG welder I have is kind of a old clunky thing. Let's see, can we do this? Attach it this guy. The weld actually blasted through here. So you can tell that the other welds were actually, you know, close to like 100% penetration, but like you don't want 100% penetration because then you have to grind the little part where it came through and rebraze it. You can see the other parts were, if that one blasted through because it was right on the groove I had ground. But those grooves are actually shockingly shallow, so the other ones were probably dangerously close to blasting through the surface. Thank you.
glass eye. I was half thinking of putting the eye on the plate first and then braising over it. But doing it this way, where I put the eye in afterwards, there's an incredibly sharp distinction between the eye and everything surrounding it. Braising everything, there would have been a risk of losing it. Woo! You'll see more when I shine it up. So this little area on both sides of the actual blade needs to be braised. It's the area in here on the dragon. Need to cut out these two little bits to bend this collar here. So I've bent I've welded the this piece, which I want to bend around top and bottom here, and then I'll just use heat and some object to bend it round. I normally weld it on this side if it's a round bar, and I'm doing lots of twists because either I'm doing just a wrap or I'm actually making loads of rings. But this one's welded top and bottom because as I fold around, if I put a weld here, it would get in the way. One of the main things to remember when you're bending and heating a wrap is to keep the heat on the part that's touching the bar. If the heat moves too far out, it'll bend at that point and create a kink. If you want to do a nice, neat wrap, keep the heat exactly where it's touching the bar. If you find yourself beating the crap out of it, you probably don't have it hot enough. If you have it hot enough, gentle taps is enough. I lovingly refer to this as my poverty anvil. The way pipe is sold is it's sold by the inner diameter, not the outer diameter. And you know, it's oftentimes to get the right sizes that actually slide over each other. Not that this is, I mean, I should have been able to get a piece of pipe that was 1 1/4 on the inside, but just they didn't have any and blah blah blah. So here I am yet again making something out of something else. These little wraps here is what I'm making. So I'm going to cut out a piece that's 2.5 inches, squish it, and then I'm going to weld it and cut out the individual pieces I need. Because this stuff is so thin, I can do a lot of the initial shaping just by squeezing it. So after the final squish, it turns out my calculation wasn't too badly off. I'm gonna not bother with the sliver and weld on top. It's actually good when you're welding to have a gap, because then when you're grinding away, the gap is made out of weld. The tricky part is going to be welding enough to get a good join, but not welding too much so it doesn't bond to this guy. It's a little bit stressful. Oh, all of the rings. Yo. If you have long hair, you have to be extra special careful around drills. I remember when I was starting off, I was drilling something with a little tiny bit, and I was, you know, I had to like make sure it was in the exact right spot. So I leaned down and some random wisp of hair caught on the chuck. Now luckily I have big strong man hair, so I didn't get scalped. It just bound up in the chuck, but it meant the chuck kept backing up on itself and my forehead kept going ka-dunk, ka-dunk, ka-dunk as it was. And you know, when they put the emergency stop things on the side of these, they're fairly big, but they're usually not designed with the idea that the guy's head is going to be stuck to the chuck. So it probably only took a couple of seconds, but it seemed like an eternity that I was flailing around like a fish trying to find the off button. This is the handle of the Guando. It's this weird speciality size pipe. I normally, like, on my swords, I like to make my handle solid, you know? But this one is so long that, like, even though the historical one is supposedly, that they have at the Purple Cloud Temple, is supposedly 100 pounds, there's writings, legend thing, that it only weighed 39. There we go. So this is a super heavy wall pipe. Like, I did the calculation, it'll only save about 6 pounds. Haha! You can definitely feel it's light, even though it's like massively heavy, still, it's lighter than a solid. This one has a 1/4 inch wall. Like, normally a pipe only has like a 8-inch wall, it's for civilian use. So the hope is with the 1/4 inch wall, that'll be plenty strong to survive all the whatnot. Much like a lot of the stuff I do, I couldn't in good conscience recommend this to anyone who's interested in, like, their fingers.
This little gadget was sent to me by a well-wisher who saw me struggling with a piece of paper on Facebook. Thanks, Mark!
Doing a blind hole like this, you know, one where it only goes down a little bit, I always get nervous with the taps. It may not be a perfect hemisphere, but it's close enough that, you know, it's closer than I would have gotten just doing it by hand. Or, not by hand. This was done by hand. You know what I mean. Just doing it by eye. This is 1.25 inches. The spearhead that has to lock into the pair of hemispheres is 1/2 inch. This is 3/8. And by doing this... I can draw a 1/2 inch slot onto the hemisphere. Oh, man. If I had access to a 1.25 inch diameter sphere, I could have made these much faster. But there you go. To do this fairly delicate grinding job, I'm going to use a cutting disc, which you're not supposed to do. But if you go easy and you only use it for super delicate stuff, it's fine. I'll do a bigger weld here. This is a placeholder just to see does it truly match what's on the other side. This is the collar. You know, this guy goes here. Bloop. But I just realized that if I could get it buried in there just the tiniest little bit, 2 or 3 millimeters, it would make the transition between the handle and the spearhead much less obvious. So I'm taking these notches out. I started with the grinder with a thin disc, cutting disc. And then I moved on to iron files just to square everything up. The disc of the grinder is nowhere near enough to do a sharp edge. You know, to cut out a sharp notch like this. So everything will be brazed over. But that's the idea of how the spearhead handle transition is going to work. So I'm going to weld around the outside and weld into the hole. Normally when I use a solid bar, I just do the cut like the bevel like super deep. But because this is a pipe, I can only do a 1/4 inch bevel. Or, you know, it's probably not even. It's a 1/4 inch wall, so that bevel's not even a 1/4 inch. And then weld in there.
normally when I'm doing this type of thing where I'm trying to level something up, that doesn't even help me much. I can use my eye looking down to see that it's in line with the handle, and I can, in theory, I thought I was going to be able to use the camera to tell that it'd have to come up or down. Although, I'm sure it's very clear to you, I'm looking at a tiny little viewfinder that's quite a ways away from me through a welding helmet. Okay, I felt the tug of a weld working. Goddamn airplane. Every summer it gets crazy here. I mean, I'm only noticing more now because I'm trying to do a talking video. So the collar fits on there. I had wanted to avoid having to do more brazing, but I guess it was inevitable. So I have to do a little bit of rebrazing on the top. Thankfully, it survived in the corners here. Possibly because I was more careful with the weld because I was worried about this guy. So I only have to braze over the top. I don't have to get into like spreading it out onto the actual blade. The idea was to not have to do any brazing like when it's like this, because if I get into having to clean up this, then there's the chance of rebrazing the surface, and then I'd have to take it off the surface again with the sandpaper and it would just get messy. So hopefully, in theory, I'll braze into the hole here, weld into this hole here, and then braze over that point, and that'll be it, and you'll have this nice sharp transition from all the brass components to the silver. So what I'm trying to do is this spearhead in the same plane as the actual plate. It's hard to tell. Stupid human eyes of, you know, focal lengths. Looks like it's in the same plane. So this is 1 1/4. This here is 1/2 inch, the blade is 1/4 inch. So if I mark it this away, I might as well get a 1/4 inch sliver to put on top of that. To account for the slight differences, I'm going to flip this around now and do the same thing but from the other side. And this will mark where I have to cut my slot. I was actually worried about what it was going to look like, so I cut a practice one. I don't normally have the spare material to do that. So we're going to cut this kind of effort.
the blade will slide in. We'll do a weld on the top, on the bottom, on these sides.
You know, this scallop is actually quite tricky to work out, and I thought I'd, having the spare material to experiment on was really good. There's nothing more stressful than when you're trying to cut out a complicated shape and you have no excess material. I'm going to weld this on before doing the dragons. I wanted to do the dragons first so I could just go kushlunk and do one weld and have it be finished, because working while it's connected to this big long handle is going to be a pain in the ass. But I can't clamp it flat then, so I'm going to have to weld this on first, you know, set up the half inch spacers or whatever, and then attach the dragon heads. Because of the unusual way I sharpen my blades, I like to set them up at a taller height than I normally work. Whoop! As I'm sharpening, I'll be checking how close I am to the edge. And also the height, the natural height for holding the grinder, is about 6 inches taller than the standard. You know, this is the height I'm going to work at, because it's less pressure on my back. So I have this, can you see the two different levels? This was the initial grind, and then this grind here was the fine tuning of the edge to bring it down to be exactly down the middle. And so then the final thing is to unify those two edges, to grind away the difference between this stepped edge that's going on now. And then once I get it down to, I've been using these Sigma Green things. They seem good. I don't know. And then once I get it down to that with these guys, I'll I'll fine tune it with the sandpaper, but afterwards kind of thing. After I do all the welding and stuff, that's when it gets the final sharpening and I call it a day. Seeing as it's the summer, I wasn't wearing my leather jacket. You can see no matter what I do. So it's always the next part up that catches fire. I'm just trying to figure out, is the flat of the spearhead spike, is it in the same plane as the blade? As near as I can tell it is. So the blade has a very subtle swoop to it, so it's not just a straight edge. It's got a very slight belly out. Because of the way I drew it, which I think is fine, it looks. So now, but now what we're testing, which that slight belly makes awkward, is squeezing it against the middle part of the blade. It's the distance between this level and the handle, because we want it to more or less look right when you look down, like it looks like this is in the same, like lines up with the blade. So I take a measurement here at the top and I get 27. I take a measurement, make sure that it's flat, make sure not to disturb it. Take a measurement down at the bottom and I get 26. So that's a 1 mil difference over around 2 feet. So when you have a difference that small, it's even hard to fix. Yeah, so I just give it the slightest pull, readjust this guy. This is the kind of stuff that can drive you insane if you let it. 27! So don't breathe and clamp this as gently as you can.
was a part here where the brass interfered with it, started to bloom. Gaseous interference with the weld solidifying, but it went away as I, you know, welded more because the brass was burned off. One of my nightmares when I was putting the spearhead on was I was going to forget about these rings. I'd only remember that they were supposed to go on first, after I had welded the head on. But luckily, it's one of the rare occasions where I did not forget. I'm just getting rid of the sharp edges from where I was welding and grinding. I don't want there to be a sharp... I'm going to braze over this like I did with the other side. So I don't want a sharp edge hiding underneath the brass, because as I buff back, the sharp edge will rise to the surface again and be silver. Whew. These darker spots are lumps of flux. I find these the brazing rods that come pre-fluxed, they leave an awful heavy coating of it. It's a hard, glassy stuff. I think it's a type of salt, but I'm not sure. I forgot to turn the camera on, but I just tacked on the dragon faces. So now it gets a weld all the way around, up till about here. And the same on the bottom. The one on the bottom is going to be a bastard to do. Yeah. Oh, it's hot here now. Ta-da! Yeah, it's gonna be a bastard. I have a sheet of plexiglass and I cut new pieces from whenever I have to do a weld and I'm slightly worried about hitting the exact right spot. I'm looking for my wire cutters. Give us a shout if you see them. The plexiglass probably doesn't last as long as the official safety glass, but I can cut a new one whenever I feel like it. And because you live on an island, the safety glass is a little bit more tricky to get. So I have this terrible tendency that the more difficult it is to do something,
the harder it is for me to remember to get the camera going. So this is that section underneath the beard where it's both welded and then brazed over. It was very hard to do. This is why I wanted to do the majority of the sharpening before all the parts were attached. This stuff here is just the dust from the final sharpening, which it comes off relatively easy when it's a thin layer, but when it's a thick layer it can pose more difficulty. It can actually, if it gets hot enough, because there's enough, you know, because the sparks build up on top of each other, if it gets hot enough it can fuse and lodge in places. I wish I had thought to film this, it would have been interesting to watch it build up. Oh well, maybe in some other video. Oh. So this monster weighs in at only 27 pounds. I weighed it, I don't have psychic powers. So I think because the brass has had a couple of days to dull down a little bit, and it's not as super bright today as it has been other days, the brass inlay is super obvious looking and easy to film. Hooray! The same goes for yon spike. You can actually see this, the contrast between the brass and the silver, way easier than any other day when I was trying to film it. At 8'3", it's almost the longest thing I've ever made. The only thing left now to do is to test it. If you're still here at the very end of the video, it probably means you like what you saw. You might consider checking out the link to the Patreon page in the video description.